The Great Fire of 64 AD spells disaster for the ancient city of Rome. Ancient writers describe how shadowy figures throw burning torches into undamaged buildings. Are these Nero's men? Or is this ancient propaganda designed to discredit the emperor? There are still many unanswered questions. Why do new fires spring up in different places across the city in an unnatural pattern? Could the answer finally exonerate Nero or prove his guilt? Nero is certainly capable of unspeakable cruelty. But archaeologist Antonio Ferrandez believes he also wants to improve his city.
Nero was a big fan of beautiful buildings and monumental Crete, but before the fire, Rome was very different.
In the years before the fire, Nero longs to rebuild and beautify Rome. He even has a new name for his new city, Neropolis.
I think that Nero was a dreamer, was very ambitious.
During the Inferno, other fires ignite at random in different parts of the city, away from the main blaze. Is this unnatural spread finally proof that arson, not accident, is behind the destruction? In Scotland, fire investigator Rory Haddon is going to examine if arson is the only explanation for this seemingly unnatural spread of fire.
Just so that when we slide it under here to put the fire out.
Rory believes flaming embers play a key role in the fire's pattern of behavior.
I just want to examine the effect that wind has on ember dispersal. So we have a fan here that's going to generate some wind for us. Then in front, we've positioned some materials that will generate some firebrands. And down here, the straw is a combustible base. If you want to go ahead and light the fire.
As the wood ignites and begins to char, it will produce a small number of fiery embers.
I'm going to turn on the wind now and see what happens with these embers.
The fan blows on the burning wood. Small embers peel off and float through the air. As soon as the embers hit the straw, it begins to smolder. Small fires spring up wherever one lands.
The firebrands generated from the pieces of wood were randomly dispersed on the combustible material. And now we have a flaming fire.
This random dispersal of embers reveals how new fires can sporadically start, seemingly out of nowhere.
What we saw here was the result of two small pieces of wood. If you imagine scaling that up to a citywide fire, we'd be generating millions of embers, and they'd be being transported by the wind and landing all over the place. To the everyday ancient Roman, this would very much have the appearance of random fires starting all across the city.
Rory's experiment reveals how wind plays a key role in the strange spread of the fire. At the height of the Inferno, a strong wind sweeps through the city. It pushes the blaze up the Palatine Hill like wildfire. But the fire also moves south against the wind. Some believe that the Inferno becomes so big, it takes on a life of its own.
With our current understanding of large fires, we know that big fires will generate their own wind. So the wind generated by the fire is potentially large enough to overcome the natural wind, and therefore distribute embers throughout the city.
The fire's behavior is disturbing, but perfectly natural to an investigator like Rory. But it can easily look like arson to an ancient Roman.
So whilst we can't definitively rule out arson, what we've seen today is a much more plausible explanation for why the fire would have appeared to spread randomly and widely across the city.
these modern tests are powerful new evidence for Nero's innocence. But if Nero is innocent, why do generations of Romans insist he is to blame for the fire? A clue could lie in the eventual fate of the Domus Aurea. Nero's palace is a mighty statement of wealth and excess. The buildings shine with gold and mother of pearl. And his statue towers over the city. But after 4 years of construction, Romans ransacked the palace. Stripping off the precious jewels and gold leaf, they drain the lake and bury the palace. On top, they build an enormous structure, the Colosseum, a symbol of a city to be shared by all Romans. Archaeologist Alessandro D'Alessio believes the sheer scale of the palace is the reason for Nero's unpopularity. The emperor turned some areas into private parkland. He creates a fantasy version of the Italian countryside in the middle of the city. Fields, woods, and vineyards sit where homes once stood. Nero proudly boasts to his friends that at last he can live like a man. He expects the citizens to admire him.
With the building of the Domus Aurea, Nero wanted to give to the people a message.
But instead, the people send him a message. After 4 years of construction, Nero is overthrown. And Rome's hated emperor commits suicide. His ultimate successor, Vespasian, knocks down the Domus Aurea and builds the Colosseum as a huge theater of gladiatorial spectacle and entertainment, open to the people, not just for one emperor.
When Nero died, the dynasty after him started to give back to the people the public space.
Nero commits many unspeakable atrocities, but new investigations reveal he is likely innocent of his greatest crime. Nero's obsession with the Domus Aurea seals his reputation.
I don't think Nero started the fire of Rome. But what is significant is that the people of Rome actually thought he might be capable of it.